of you who are new here, we just want to start with a short introduction of Marc and Andrew. So Dr. Marc Gafni is a leading public intellectual and a teacher impacting the source code of global culture. Gafni is a visionary thinker, a social activist, and a passionate philosopher. He is known for his source code teachings, including the unique self theory and the five cells, the amorous cosmos, a politics of evolutionary love, a return to eros, and digital intimacy. He is the author of 25 books, of which 10 books have been published, including the award-winning Your Unique Self, The Radical Path to Personal Enlightenment. He holds his doctorate in philosophy from Oxford University, as well as Orthodox rabbinic ordination. He teaches on the cutting edge of philosophy and spirit in the West with the aim of participating in the articulation of what Dr. Gafni, together with Dr. Zach Stein and their colleagues, are calling a cosmo-erotic humanism. At the core of cosmo-erotic humanism is what they are calling first principles and first values, anthro-ontology, a universal grammar of value. This is the ground for a new shared universe story and a new narrative of identity for the new human and the new humanity, the emergence from Homo sapiens to Homo amor. This shared story, rooted in first principles and first values, can then serve as the matrix for a global ethos, for a global civilization. Marc Gafni is the co-founder with Ken Wilber and Sally Kempton of the Center for Integral Wisdom, where he serves as its co-president. Together with Dr. Zach Stein, they are co-leading a team of thinkers articulating this new vision of meaning for the world. The previous chairs of the Center for Integral Wisdom include Barbara Marx Hubbard, Lori Galperin, John P. Mackey, Carrie Kish, and Adam Bellow. And our current chairs are Sharif Melnick and Gabrielle Anwar. Marc also served as the co-chair together with Barbara Marx Hubbard and now is the director of the Foundation for Conscious Evolution. Together with the late Barbara Marx Hubbard, he co-founded One Mountain, Many Paths, a global communion of pioneering souls committed to articulate a new story for a new humanity. And as Marc and Barbara said together, a planetary awakening in love through unique self symphonies. All of these movements have recently come together under the Office for the Future, initiated by Barbara Marx Hubbard, Dr. Gafni, Dr. Stein, and visionary leadership partners from around the world. And with that, I give my words to you, Daniela, to introduce Andrew Cohen. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Krista. It's a pleasure for me to introduce Andrew Cohen to all of you, for the ones that don't know yet about him. So Andrew Cohen is a spiritual teacher, author, cultural visionary, and inspirational speaker. His work has been acclaimed by luminaries worldwide, from academics to philosophers to teachers of all faiths and none. From 1991 to 2010, he was editor-in-chief of the award-winning Enlightened Next magazine, a widely cherished publication that explored the deepest existential questions of our time with some of the world's most noted thought leaders. Andrew has become known for his willingness to boldly cast aside the sacred cows of the spiritual world. His work grapples with demystifying the wealth of knowledge found in the great wisdom traditions and with making enlightenment deeply relevant to a postmodern audience. In 2020, he and a small group of collaborators launched the online project Manifest Nirvana, a virtual ashram and a monastery of the future, which Andrew has called a home for sovereign souls, radical spirits, and integral pioneers. In his three decades of teaching and lecturing, he has developed a unique and powerful vision for a truly contemporary spirituality, combining evolutionary theory and integral developmental practice with the timeless wisdom of the perennial philosophy. Departing radically from a traditional Eastern approach, Andrew's pioneering Dharma evolution enlightenment calls not for transcendence of the world, but for a deep and heroic responsibility for its evolution. And with that, Andrew, I hand over to you.
Hello, everybody. Welcome. Nice to see all of you. So before we begin, Marc and I decided together that we would like a fundamental theme for these dialogues that we have, we're having ongoingly, to be one of mutual benefit. In other words, we wanted to try and come together in this context and speak our heart's desire to everybody, but we wanted to do so in a spirit of love and cooperation. And some people call this new spirit of love and cooperation Game B. So Game B means I'm as interested in your welfare and your well-being, and in this context, your liberation, your enlightenment, and your freedom, and your happiness, as I am in my own. Because the idea with this Game B thinking is that for most of human history, in almost all fields of human endeavor, human beings have been competing with each other. And this competition has led to great benefit. But we wanted to try and do these dialogues together in a spirit of genuine cooperation, genuine love and mutual self-interest, and genuine care for each other. And we hope that as we speak together, we're able to transmit a genuine feeling of fellowship between us, because this is what the world needs now more than ever, as we all know. So I think Marc wanted to say a few words about this before I begin. Hi, Marc.
Mute. There we go. Yay. Thank you, Andrew. Thank you. And I love your shirt. That's a great shirt. I feel a little boring in my black shirt, but we'll talk about it. Maybe I've got a little shirt envy here that I'll have to deal with and maybe see some therapy or something. Yay. Welcome. Thank you very much for that beginning. And just to say a word about that, because Andrew, we've been talking about this in behind the scenes conversations. It's so often that the spiritual world, with all of its beauty, operates by the same principles as the rest of the world, right? So for example, in pre-modernity, we talk about spirituality being, you know, in some sense corrupt in many ways, but we forget that wasn't that spirituality was corrupt. It's that governance was corrupt, and spirituality was, it's not that there was great government and bad spirituality. No, the entire system, pre-modernity, de-emphasized and devalued universal human rights ethics on multiple levels. And the same thing is true today. Spirituality all too often imitates all the other fields, and it commodifies ideas, sells them. And it's not that we shouldn't use methodologies of invitation or marketing. Those are, of course, legitimate. But the question is, what's the beating heart, right? What's the one breath that's holding it all? And Andrew and I talked about two dialogues ago, this notion that the generator function for existential risk is literally win-lose metrics. And so to change this, we have to actually create new intimacy, new, if you will, evolutionary intimacy. And what Andrew and I would just be madly delighted to do with each other, and Andrew, we've talked about this so many times, is just to love each other and to support each other. And from that place, right, well out, right, love it open, right, and take these revolutionary steps. So that's our context for this conversation. And Andrew, I think you're opening today, sir.
Okay, amen. Thank you.
Amen.
So what we wanted to speak about, our third dialogue, was we wanted to speak about what we feel is the significance of higher states of consciousness, the significance of the experience of higher states of consciousness, and the inherently countercultural role that the experience of higher states of consciousness has on the human psyche, the human heart, the human soul. So I just wanted to just speak briefly about my own experience of higher states, very briefly. And I have to say that higher states have changed, completely changed my life. They've changed the direction of my life. They have become the central organizing principle in my relationship to being alive and my relationship to being a human being. My first initiation was when I was 16 years old. I was sitting up late one night having a conversation with my mother. We were living in Rome, Italy. I don't remember what we were talking about, but suddenly, for no apparent reason, the doors of perception opened, and it seemed like all the walls in our apartment disappeared, and I suddenly found myself sitting in the middle of eternity. I was overwhelmed by a feeling of love that was physically unbearable. I knew in some miraculous way that there was no such thing as death, and that all points in space were exactly the same place. I had never experienced so much happiness, so much joy. This awareness of infinity, inherent in this awareness of infinity, which was timeless and formless and beginningless and endless, was a self-conscious intelligence that knew everything and understood everything. And the nature of this intelligence, as I said, was the kind of love that was inconceivable, unimaginable. And I suddenly felt for the first time in my life that I was alive, and I knew what it meant to be alive. And this was my spiritual initiation, because before that point in my life, I'd been a secular materialist. Now I knew that God existed. And it took me several days to recover from this extraordinary visitation from the unknown. But this compelled me, 6 years later, to become a true seeker. Because I realized that at a certain point that nothing else in my life got near making me as happy as I was in those moments, and enabled me to understand what it meant to be alive and what the meaning and purpose of life was. So I yearned to rediscover and re-experience this miraculous higher state of consciousness. And I sought out different kinds of spiritual teachers and different practices and methods, and did all the things that true seekers do, which eventually, like so many others before me, led me to come to Mother India. And in 1986, I had the good fortune to meet my guru, the great H.W. Alpunja. And I met him when I was 31 years old. And within about 10 minutes of sitting in his presence, sitting before him, I had an experience that was the beginning of my experience of liberation. I asked this extraordinary man how much effort did one have to make if one wanted to be free. And he whispered that I didn't have to make any effort to be free, and I didn't understand what he was talking about. But in those few moments, in my mind's eye, I saw water flowing down the side of a mountain. I knew without any doubt that my own true nature was like that water, ever unobstructed and always freely flowing. And I knew in a way that's hard to describe in words that unenlightenment was only a thought. I knew I'd always been free. And in that instant, this took about 20 or 30 seconds. I was sitting in silence and I had this realization. And at the end of those 20 or 30 seconds, he shouted out loud, "That's it." And I said, "How did you know?" And he burst out laughing. He said, "When you see your own face, you could recognize it." So meeting my guru introduced me to a completely different world, a completely different dimension of reality. That's when I learned the difference between absolute reality and relative reality, that which is absolutely real and that which is relatively real. And as I became a teacher myself at a very young age, I began introducing people to this leap from relative reality to absolute reality. And I came to understand more and more and appreciate more and more that when human beings awaken to this non-relative or absolute dimension of reality, of existence, of consciousness, we enter into a completely different world. We enter into a completely different state of being. We enter into a completely different part of ourselves. And that's when we realize that love is the essence of all things, and that there is inherent meaning and purpose in this mysterious play of consciousness that we call the evolving universe. And I realized that my life's mission from that point on was to awaken people to this absolute state so we could meet each other in heaven. And once we can meet each other in heaven beyond relative reality, we become inspired to want to create that heaven on earth. So I think that from a spiritual perspective, the most important thing is that we experience higher, we have the experience of a higher state of consciousness, one that blows us out of our minds and egos so radically and so completely that we wake up in a way, we wake up in such a way that we understood what the Buddha was talking about when he spoke about enlightenment. We understood what Jesus was speaking about when he spoke about love. When we experience these higher states in a way that is profound enough and deep enough and mind-blowing enough, we actually begin to understand where these great luminaries and realizers were speaking from. We experience that place, that inner space from which they were speaking in ourselves. And it's from that point on, it's a completely different life. It's a completely different relationship to life. We discover a completely different reason to exist and to be ourselves and to live the life we're living. So there are inherently countercultural implications in experiencing these kinds of higher states. And I think that Marc wanted to speak a little bit about his own experience of higher states of consciousness. But after that, I think it'd be great if we could explore the profoundly revolutionary countercultural implications of the experience of higher states of consciousness. Hi, Marc.
Yay. Thank you, Andrew. Thank you. And friends, Andrew and I, when we talked a couple of days ago, and actually even right before the dialogue, we thought that we would open up, and which is really the only authentic way to open up with our a little bit of our own personal experience, and then, you know, move to kind of map together what this means and why this is important and why it's actually, you know, the most important thing. All progress in human history, all evolution in every field always and only comes from higher states of consciousness. So without higher states of consciousness, we can't actually move forward. And the alternative, you know, to higher states of consciousness, you know, as I think, who was it who said that? David Foster Wallace, you know, so the rat race, right? The alternative, and David, of course, suffered from depression and in the end committed suicide, right? I mean, it's a tragic story. But the alternative to higher states of consciousness is not ordinary consciousness. It's not that there's extraordinary or ordinary. The alternative is depression, breakdown, contraction, you know, and pain. And this notion of higher states of consciousness, maybe just one more sentence, and then maybe I'll share a little bit in our the lineage tradition that I grew up in, we're very reticent about actually sharing, you know, personal stories. In the Kabbalistic tradition, there's almost, unless you really look, but in the public texts, there's very little. So I'm a little reticent, but I'll share a little bit. But before that, just some context. And it's a shocking notion, but what we call higher states of consciousness in the lineage tradition, for example, of Kabbalah, is called prophecy. That's what prophecy is, right? In prayer, the human being initiates and invokes. And in prophecy, the divine initiates and invokes. But there are two sides of the same coin, prayer, right, and prophecy. And the most fundamental understanding of enlightenment or prophecy is that every human being is commanded to be a prophet. And that's actually the deep understanding, as my teacher early on, Joseph Soloveitchik, said very beautifully. He said, you're obligated because you can. And that's how he read a wonderful passage in Maimonides, that every human being is obligated as the matrix of their essential identity to transcend their narrow identity and to become a prophet. There's an obligation to prophecy. That's a shocking idea. And what does that mean? Is there a democratization of prophecy? What are levels of attainment? So hopefully we'll talk about all that, but I just want to kind of set that as a context. So when Andrew and I are sharing about our personal experiences, and it's not that everyone has the same experiences, they don't, but we're not claiming exclusive access to these experiences. We're sharing because for both of us, we've committed our lives to listening to these experiences and to having them guide us and not relegating them and to them being the organizing principle of our waking and breathing days. But that's an invitation to everyone. And that's what we mean by democratization. We'll talk more about it. So maybe I'll just share a little bit. When I was also 16, right? Strangely enough, right? I was also 16. It's when my teacher died. And my teacher's name was Pinky Bach, died at 32. we were in the middle of an ecstatic party. It was a Purim party. And Purim is the holy day of ecstasy, where there's literally halachically, meaning legally in the law, an obligation to get, how would I describe it, highly intoxicated. And the most pious masters, right, 2 days a year go into ecstasy. And one of them is Purim. The other is called Lag BaOmer, when we'll talk about later. And Purim, I would go to my teacher's house, who was the most straight, you know, conventional, you know, classical. And he would say, okay, it's time to fulfill the mitzvah of Purim. He'd pour the first drink. And we would just keep drinking until we were gone, right? And the teaching is that in that place, you move into the absolute, right? Once a year, but it's actually a kind of a sacred intoxication. So this teacher of mine, Pinky Bach, we're now in Purim. We're in the Purim holiday. He's dancing next to me and he could dance. And I can literally hear him in my mind's eye, heart's feeling now, screaming Lebedik, which means dance, right? Ecstasy. And he falls down. He had an aneurysm. He was literally my father in every possible way. He looks up at me and he says, go on without me. And he passes away. And in those moments, and in the days and weeks afterward, I began to wander the streets of Riverdale, New York, which is part of the Bronx, by the way, but they don't admit it. And I would sing, I would chant, which was a sacred opening. And I would chant like for hours. And in those hours of chanting, I would wander down to the Spuytendeuvel Riverdale bus station, this kind of little junkyard with an old broken down train, and just chant for hours. And I literally, it was the most real time, more real than anything else, could feel the intimate whisper of personal infinity holding me in her arms, loving me madly, right? Outrageously, right? Like complete love and complete recognition and complete holding and any sense of being alone, right? Or being alienated simply wasn't a reality. It was that clear, right? And that obvious and that self-evident. So that's one, and I'm just gonna give you one other, you know, very shortly, and then we'll open up, but just to kind of feel it, because often it comes in moments of pain, right? There's entry through joy, and joy is something that in the lineage and with my students, we talk every day about choosing joy with my friends, with my colleagues, right? There's a complete and radical demand for joy, right? And there's embodied ecstasy, which is a different conversation, right? Which brings higher cognition. But I want to talk just in the opening about the moments of pain, because pain breaks us open. So in 2006, I had a tragic moment, right, in my life where there was a several months where I didn't know how things were going to go. I was in the midst of a tragic injustice, and I didn't have access at that moment to things that I thought I needed to transform it. And I had no idea what was gonna happen. And I was in Salt Lake City, Utah. And my friends, Michael and Di and I had rented an apartment for me. And I was living there alone. And it was about 4 or 5 months I was there alone. And every night I would open the book of Psalms written by David, father of Solomon. And I would just cry. I would read the Psalms, and David was literally in the room holding me, and Shekhinah, goddess, held me. And for hours, I would just read the Psalms and cry. And I was completely held. And it was more intimate than any imaginable intimacy, and more alive and more true. And nothing else mattered. And none of the external circumstance could change the depth and truth of that intimacy. And I understood again that we live in an intimate universe. That's the absolute truth of our reality, and that we're personally addressed and held and called in every second as the most real truth of reality. Right? Wow. Right? And from that, I live every day. And I go back to it every day, not just to the memory of it, but to actually find and live in genuine ecstasis, right? Genuine higher consciousness, genuine outrageous love every day. And if I couldn't access it, I would die. Right? That's the place that I'm able to live and be at home. And from there, right, as part of just the fabric of life, everything else flows. So Andrew, it was amen to introduce, and maybe take us, take it away, brother. Thank you.
Yeah. Amen. That was very beautiful. Thank you. And my own feeling when I was a seeker was that if I couldn't find access back to that higher state of consciousness where everything seemed so clear, that I didn't know how I could make sense out of the human experience. I didn't know how I could live. And when Marc was just speaking about this, I would rather die than, if I can't be truly alive, I'd rather be dead. Something that I can actually relate to. So what I wanted to reiterate before we go to the next step in this dialogue together is I wanted to reiterate that, as Marc was explaining, that one aspect of these higher states of consciousness are experiences of joy and happiness that are utterly and completely liberating. And they really do set us free. They set us free, they liberate us. But for me, what's even more important than the experiences of joy is the repetitive rediscovery in these higher states. That in these higher states of consciousness, our perspective changes. We suddenly awaken to a capacity to cognize reality that is infinitely more real, that we recognize in a way that we can't justify with the rational mind. That we realize that how we're experiencing reality is infinitely more real than anything we ever experienced when we were merely relatively conscious, relatively awake, and alive. So it's this awakening in, through these higher states to what we discover to be absolutely real. It's coming face to face with reality that is so profound. It's so profound. It's suddenly we realize that we may have been alive for 20, 30, 40, 50, 60, 70 years, but in relationship to what it means to actually be fully conscious, we realize that we've been sleepwalking our whole lives. And most people do that without even knowing it. That's the tragedy. So waking up to these higher states is not only a source of liberating joy and happiness, that's completely intoxicating. And as I've been repeating, utterly liberating, that's the important key word here. But it's the discovery of that which we recognize to be absolutely real. And so when we wake up to what we recognize to be absolutely real, it becomes obvious to us that to make sense out of the human experience, for the human experience to make sense, we have to be so awake, we have to be full, we have to be conscious, we have to be in touch with absolute reality, we have to be in touch with the real. Because if we're not, we're not going to be able to make the kind of choices that express the fact that we've woken up in such a profound way. So these higher states are, from a certain point of view, if we actually get serious about transformation, about enlightenment, the experience of these higher states of consciousness become essential, not just so we can feel well, but so we can be in touch with reality. So it's a leap from relative reality to absolute reality. And in my own personal life, I mean, I can't claim to be awake all the time, but I wake up quite often, many, many times a week. And each and every time I wake up again, I am shocked and touched, and just like it was the first time. Because as they say in Vedanta, God is Satchitananda, being consciousness bliss that is ever new. And there's something about the experience of these higher states of consciousness, when we wake up to that which is absolutely real. There's a unique quality of it being ever new. It's always like the first time. It's never like the second time. It's never like, oh, I already know you. It's always like the first time. The awe and the wonder and the awe and the wonder and the majesty of what we behold always strikes us anew. And that's when we rediscover our lost innocence yet again and again and again. And as I was saying, if we're living a spiritual teaching that's powerful, it can help us to have these kind of experiences often enough to keep us awake. So the second thing I wanted to introduce, and I think Marc and I wanted to speak about in different ways, was that these kinds of experiences force us to question who we actually are and what we're actually doing here. Like when anybody wakes up in a profound way, there's a deep question: who am I really? And what is it that I'm actually doing here in this life that God has given me? So spiritual experiences, the experience of higher states of consciousness that are truly deep, that really blast our hearts wide open and allow us to experience what Marc calls outrageous love and open up our mind in ways that allows us to have an experience of cognizing reality that is absolutely mesmerizing. It compels us to re-examine the nature of our own identity, to re-examine it, to question it. Who am I really? And what am I doing here in this world? And usually what happens then is we begin to question a lot of things that we have been told by our teachers, maybe even by our parents, by our culture. And so there is a profoundly countercultural aspect to awakening. When profound awakening to higher states, if and when we really wake up, it forces us to question very deeply, who am I and why am I here and what's the purpose of all this? And compels an inspired soul to do anything and everything necessary to somehow live one's human incarnation as some kind of manifestation and an expression of that higher knowing. And that's what living the spiritual life in earnest is really all about, is becoming a manifest expression through our awakened humanity of the glory of God. That's what we realize, and then suddenly the future opens up before us in a different way, because we realize we're here to bear witness through this incarnation. We're here to bear witness and become in and through our own imperfection, an expression of the glory of God. And we realize there's nothing more we can do than that. That's the ultimate expression of gratitude to the absolute. And it takes courage, because then we have to stand forth and bear witness, stand forth and be counted. Yes, I am that. I am that. God is the ultimate reality, the ultimate truth. And I know that, and I'm here to, in and through my imperfect body, mind, and personality, to be an expression of that. And ideally, we want to do so in such a way that will inspire others. And this is what I think Marc was speaking about as part of his introduction. When we wake up, we realize, as he was saying, that we're all being called. Now, many of us haven't heard the call. When we experience these higher states of consciousness, we do begin to hear that call. And if we have enough courage, we will eventually say, yes, not my will, but thy will be done. Okay, Marc.
Beautiful. So let me dive in, Andrew, to some of the pieces you put on the table. And maybe this will kind of conclude our introductory piece, and we'll move to the next step. But just before I dive into some of the beautiful things that Andrew, you put on the table, let me just frame for a couple people just for a second for us. We'll come to some of the very, very important issues of what does it mean to democratize higher consciousness? That's one issue we want to talk about. I just want to kind of put that on the table because I know lots of people have asked us about that. What are levels of attainment? What does that mean? A second issue we need to talk about, which we'll come to later, is there's an entire movement to kind of hack higher consciousness. You know, Stephen Kotler wrote a book, you know, The Rise of Superman, you know, a bunch of years ago. So there's a whole literature on hacking higher consciousness. And what does that mean? Right? Is there an invitation there? Is there a danger there? What are they? And so we need to kind of just look at that and feel into that, just kind of, so kind of putting those aside for a second, taking those off the table. And what are the shadows, right, of higher consciousness? So those are all, because I think I could feel that all those issues rising in my heart and mind. So I'm sure that they're rising in a lot of people's hearts and minds. So we're going to definitely engage all of that in the course of the conversation. But for now, I want to ask everyone to, if you can, put it aside, because Andrew and I want to talk about it itself. And before we talk about the shadows and the, you know, Andrew, you spoke so beautifully about it itself. Let's just actually go into what that actual experience is and why it, you know, so insanely matters. So I want to pick up with this gorgeous phrase that you introduced, Andrew, Sat Chit Ananda, right, which is a beautiful way in, right? And as many of you know, from studying either in our world or Andrew's world or other places, you know, Sat, right, is the sense of being, right? Chit is a sense of consciousness, and Ananda, hard word to translate. It's actually one of the neurochemicals is anandamide, right? When your state shifts from kind of the ordinary consciousness of anxiety, and you have norepinephrine and cortisol, and you know, you've got beta, you know, fast, you know, kind of waves moving in your brain, you're feeling lots of anxiety, and then you shift to higher consciousness, so you get a different set of neurochemicals, and one of them is anandamide, right? That's what they actually called it, not by accident, and of course also dopamine and serotonin and oxytocin, you know, and you move from, you know, beta to alpha and even some theta, right? And your hypofrontal cortex kind of goes offline. So there's these things, right? This interior state we know shows up, you know, physically in the body in very clear ways, which is part of the reason people are trying to hack this. And what does it mean to hack it? And why is hacking higher consciousness actually potentially explosive in a negative way, right? And what are the downsides of hacking higher consciousness outside of a dharma, right? Outside of a code of ethos, right? Outside of a, you know, a deep intentionality, right? For the good, the true, and the beautiful, right? Then it's a commodifying of higher consciousness that we have to watch out for. But let's go back to, I just did a little segue on anandamide, right? You're talking about Sat Chit Ananda. So I just mentioning that neurochemical that's released, you know, when we shift. But Sat Chit Ananda, let's translate Ananda, and Andrew, we could spend hours talking about how to translate Ananda, and there's, of course, huge scholarly literature on that question. You know, what does that word actually mean? But for now, let's call it love, bliss, joy, right? You know, good enough, right? This experience of love, bliss, joy. And what this text is really saying, very similar to the Hebrew wisdom text, that the voice of the divine emerges from between the erotically entwined cherubs above the Ark of the Covenant in Solomon's temple in the Holy of Holies. So the word of the divine, that is to say higher consciousness, emerges from the empty space between the erotically alive cherubs entwined. And that space between them, right? That's the inside space. And it's called in Hebrew mysticism, it's called lifnai v'lifnim, right? The inside of the inside. So sat, right? It's being, and then the inside of being is chit, consciousness. Then the inside of consciousness is ananda, love, or outrageous love. So it's the inside of the inside, right? That's really what we're saying. We're saying that the inside of reality is higher consciousness. It pulses with higher consciousness. It's actually what Andrew called so beautifully, it's what's really real, right? That's the inside of the inside. That's interiority. That lives inside of us, right? We live in an intimate universe. The intimate universe lives in us. And so in this invitation to prophecy, right? You know, that is extended to every human being. And Andrew mentioned a word that we use a lot, which is outrageous love. And outrageous love is actually a translation of a text of David's. He calls it Ahava Azah, outrageous love. And outrageous love means, right? And here, Andrew, what you said, you know, was you know, very moving to me, and I identify it with very much. If I don't come back several times a day, a week, an hour, right, to an actual experience of being on the inside, my heart breaks. And my heart breaks from the pain, right? I mean, and you know, we live in a world of outrageous pain, right? It's outrageously painful. And we also live in a world of outrageous beauty. It's outrageously beautiful. But the only response to the beauty or to the pain is outrageous love. But by outrageous love, we don't mean a, right? The outrageous lover, right? We're all outrageous lovers in our core, keeps every boundary that should be kept, right? It's not a license, right? But also breaks every boundary of smallness and contraction that needs to be broken, right? So the outrageous lover keeps every boundary that should be kept and breaks every boundary that should be broken and is outrageous, right? And the teacher has to be fully ethical and fully outrageous, right? And that's a daring thing to say, right? The teacher can't be running a popularity contest. And we're all students and we're all teachers, right? But here I'm talking about, we have a responsibility to write, to formulate dharma, right? To teach, but we actually have to move to a world where there's no longer just an elite that lives, that loves their way to enlightenment, right? And loving your way to enlightenment, right, is this key path. But loving your way to enlightenment means, it means falling in love all the time, right? Right, with ideas, with people, right, with places, right? It means actually experiencing again and again and again the experience of falling in love, right? Falling in love with the divine, falling in love with the absolute, right? Again and again and again. And if we're going to respond to existential risk in this moment in history, we simply won't get there, right? Based on an elite that's the only people who are holding this outrageous love or this deep awakening. And everyone else is basically on Facebook and social media being manipulated by, right, what Alex Pentland at MIT Labs calls social physics, a kind of Skinner behaviorist reward technology that's based on algorithms, which essentially can predict human beings at their lowest common denominator. And this is really just, this is critical. And Andrew, I want to just talk to you about this, right? And as our whole Facebook social media world is based on the lowest common denominator of a human being. We have the ability to manipulate, predict what human beings will do based on what Pentland calls all of their unconscious actions. And as Pentland says, interiors don't matter at all. And I was just talking to a CEO this week of a major company. And he said, what they're doing at Google is Facebook is fine because this is what people want. No, people in their default setting are going to often go to their lowest common denominator. That's what we do. Right. And we have an entire complex, the nervous system of the planet, which is social media, that speaks to human beings at their lowest common denominator, interrupts their attention all the time, steals their attention, hijacks their interiority, or ignores it, and essentially predicts and manipulates for the sake of, you know, auctions happening all the time run by Google and Facebook, right? Your personal information profile sold, you know, to the highest bidder. Literally every second, billions of times a second, as we're talking right now. What we're saying is no, that's not what the human being is, right? That's not the human being. We're in the Tao, right? We're on the inside of the inside, and that we have to choose Metatron, right? We have to choose higher consciousness. And we have to practice it constantly. We have to choose it constantly. And in some sense, and I'm gonna turn right to you, brother, it's a radical invitation, right? Which is, do I wanna be basically live in a world of upgraded algorithms that I'm another downgraded human being, manipulated? Or do I want to end that trance and actually choose my prophecy, right? Which is my unique self, right? Choose my radical, absolute commitment to be outrageous. And I might, you know, some things might get broken along the way, like my heart, but there's nothing more whole than a broken heart. And we have to be prepared to be outrageous, you know. And last sentence, and I give it to you, a dear friend of mine who chaired the center for a bunch of years and a great guy. I had dinner with him this week and we used to laugh. He said, Mark, let's not call it outrageous love. That's a little too, let's call it unlimited love. And I said, no, it's outrageous, right? And it's outraged, right, at all the pain, and it feels outrageous, and it's breaking the boundary of that small, right, contracted self. And it's risky, but it's the unique risk of my life. So just an invitation to outrageous, to actually say, I'm committed to being a prophet, to going all the way in this lifetime. And that's, I mean, if there's many things we share, in many ways we're very, very, very different, but I'd say the deepest thing we share, I'm just making this up in a second, so correct me, besides the fact you got a better shirt that we've already established, right, is a sense that we want to go the whole way in this lifetime. And we want to invite as many people who want to come on the journey, right, to actually do that for real. So I turn to you, brother.
Amen. And I'd like to, amen, that was beautiful. And I think that I'm sure that everybody who's with us online now would agree that we want to wake up from the trance, absolutely. And we want to live a life of outrageous love and outrageous freedom. So another thing I wanted to say about the significance of the experience of higher states of consciousness, very much in response to the spiritual potential inherent in the human experience that you've been describing, is that when we experience higher states of consciousness, something very fascinating happens. And I'm speaking very much from my own experience, but I know this is true for most people. When we're in a higher state of consciousness, we lose our fear of death. I know that I do. Because the reason I lose my fear is death is because suddenly I'm awake to eternity and I realize there's no such thing as death. So when I'm awake in these higher states and it make it possible for me to be awake, I lose my fear of death. I'm not afraid of dying. And so I'm no longer, as a result of this higher state of consciousness, clinging on to the life of the body, the life of the personality, the life of my unenlightened mind, which in my unenlightened states of consciousness seems so important. But when I awaken to higher states of consciousness, I realize that they're only relatively real. They're not real. And so in these higher states of consciousness, I lose my fear of death. And as I lose my fear of death, I experience the infinite potential, the infinite creative potential inherent in the life process. And inherent in the life process means that when I become awake to the evolutionary impulse, the creative energy and intelligence, it gave rise to the universe and is giving rise to it all the time. And I experience that vibration pulsating within my nervous system, within my being. I experience a fearlessness and a unquenchable desire to create the future and to be fully here and to really make a mark, but not for myself, for the sake of life itself, because I realize how important it is. So these higher states of consciousness awaken in us a fearlessness and a inspired, a purely positive, inspired creative passion to live this life fully. And in this case, then we want to love fully and fearlessly. And we no longer want to live for ourselves, because we realize this is not about me. This was never about me. This was about the whole universe. That this incarnation was never about me. It's about the whole universe. Awakening to itself and becoming conscious of itself through the body, mind, personality of myself. But my body, mind, and personality, I realize as a result of this higher state of consciousness, it's just a vehicle. This body is a vehicle. This mind is a vehicle. This personality is a vehicle. That's not who I am. And then I want to use this vehicle for the sake of the evolutionary process itself. And I feel called to do that by my awareness of absolute spirit. And just in response to what you were bringing up, in those higher states of consciousness, I feel so inspired not to compromise. I want to live my highest truth. I want to live my highest aspirations. I want to live this life with the highest level of integrity. I want there to be justice in this world. And you and I have had this, briefly, we've discussed this once. I want this world to be a just place. But it's not for me. It's because the universe wants itself to be a just and perfect place. And in these higher states of consciousness, I realize that is true. And this is part of what the revelation of God is all about. that God cares desperately. And when we awaken these higher states of consciousness, we begin to experience that desperate care that God is vibrating, pulsating in and through our own enlightened awareness. And then we become a completely different kind of person. We become a completely different kind of person because we're living for very different reasons than most people live. We're not here to have and to get and to become for ourselves. We're here to create the universe anew. And this is what the utopian vision is all about. And of course, it all expresses itself in different cultures, different times in history, in different ways. But it's this liberated, brokenhearted, fully committed aspiration to do whatever we need to do to make this world the best possible place it can be. So the experience of higher states of consciousness liberates us from our personal fears and our personal concerns, our culturally conditioned fears and our culturally conditioned concerns, and makes us at least feel, I hope this doesn't sound the wrong way, but it makes us feel at least a little bit like Superman, but in the right way for the right reasons, not in the sense of being arrogant and superior, but that the bliss and the joy of these higher states of consciousness becomes a superpower. It frees us from being lost in the trance you're speaking about, and makes us experience a ferocious conviction to break the trance. And within reason, to wake as many people up from their trance as possible so we can change the world together. And philosophy is one thing, but when spirit awakens to itself within us, we feel so compelled. We feel so compelled. And it's the awakened fearlessness and awakened evolutionary passion. It's having those kinds of experiences that so absolutely personally transforming and so spiritually empowering. It's so important to us. Because as we know, we're living in a very difficult time in human history, and it's very easy for us to individually, collectively fall into a state of despair and depression, because there's a lot to feel in despair and a lot to be depressed about. And sometimes we know we should be doing better and we should be doing the right thing, but when we experience these higher states of consciousness, all of the inertia and all the resistance is blown away and we feel there's nothing in our way. So these higher states are so important, so that we experience again and again and again that there's nothing in our way.
Gorgeous, 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 gorgeous. So let me pick up on that, this sense of, three things. And I'm gonna try and, what we're kind of doing, everyone, if you're noticing, is we're each talking for about 7 or 8 minutes, touching on something that the other said, and kind of trying to map this picture. And we're trying to kind of create a whole picture together. So let me pick up, Andrew, on that word, right, which you talk about kind of moving beyond the personal. And this is something we've talked about before in the past, and we've actually argued about in the past and in beautiful, Dharma, holy combat. I actually wound up writing a book on it. And then, right as I was about to, begin to kind of get excited about that book, you went on vacation to India. So we didn't really get to talk about that book, but now you're kind of deep in gorgeous teaching mode. And I went on vacation for a couple of years in my life to Salt Lake City. And those vacation times are kind of the deep dives that we do. So I want to talk about that word personal. And I think we've come actually to a deep shared understanding of this at this point. I think we've moved full circle. So, and Andrew, you're going to correct me here if I get this wrong, but the way Andrew and I now, I think, have a shared understanding of moving beyond the personal means moving beyond the ego self, right? The personal petty concerns, right? Moving beyond, right? Like that's what we're talking about. And we have now this deep understanding that beyond the input, so there's kind of the personal, which we'll call the personal that Andrew, that you're talking about, which is petty concerns, contractions. Then above that, we have the higher states bring us to this impersonal, right? And this identification with this impersonal. And then beyond the impersonal, it's kind of like in Kashmir Shaivism, there's duality, non-duality. So beyond the impersonal, there's the impersonal personal, right? There's this new intensification of the personal, which I would call unique self, and Andrew calls authentic self, and which are not quite the same, different conversation, but what we're now deeply sharing over the years is that there's this intense personal calling, right? That it's not about leaving yourself behind, right? It's about this higher individuation beyond ego. And that higher states of consciousness used to be about leaving the personal self behind. And what outrageous love tells us, right? And what the authenticity of the personal authenticity of authentic self, right? To use your phrase, authentic self has to be personally authentic. That is to say, I am personally addressed and needed by reality, right? And that's the actual experience of higher states of consciousness. I mean, if I had to, Andrew, if I had to kind of, you know, sum up in like a, you know, a cheap second, cheap grace, you know, what's the actual experience of higher states of consciousness? You know, from this perspective, you know, you got a call from, I don't know, Barack Obama. He said, hey, Jack, it's Barack here. Barack, really? You don't really believe him. Then you've established that it's Barack. And you realize that Barack's been tracking you forever, knows everything about you, your earliest childhood, right? Every detail of your life, your dreams said and unsaid. And then Barack says to you, Jack, I need you. I can't do this without you. I'm behind the scenes on Joe Biden here. I'm making the whole thing happen, right? Joe's great, you know, but I'm making this happen for real. I mean, Joe's awesome and me and Joe are partnering and Joe and I talked last night and we just need you. And you realize as they describe your gifts to you, as Joe and Barack describe your gift to you, you realize, oh my God, that's exactly my gift. And I never knew that it was absolutely needed by all of reality, not just by my personal circle, that me being that, right, is the very essence and purpose of my life for which all of reality breathes and conspired. And through that, through being that, through transforming in that way, my transformation quite literally transforms the entire thing, right? That experience, right, is the experience of outrageous love, this radical personal address, right? So we move beyond the personal that Andrew's talking about, which is this contracted personal. We move into this radical, right, true self. And then we move beyond it and we just have this radical experience of being addressed. So from that place, I want to just throw on the table. And again, I want to be really transparent with everyone. I'm watching time carefully because, you know, even when you're ecstatic and doing a dialogue, right, you're deeply ethical. So I'm watching just that Andrew and I are talking around the same amount of time, right? So that we're kind of tracking close to each other. And I want to share that with everyone because that's what you do. In ecstasy, you don't lose track of the details. So because that these are the little ways we love each other, right? Because Andrew and I could, we get excited, we go on for a couple hours, right? So I'm about 3 or 4 minutes in here. So I want to just pick up two pieces of this. So I want to throw a practice on the table. Okay, so one of the practices, Andrew, that you've pioneered in the world, right, is certain forms of meditation, particularly intersubjective meditation. You've done gorgeous work in what you call intersubjective non-duality, right? And which is, you know, and we call that, right, in the center, and we came from different places, but we arrived at a similar place. We call that, right, unique self-symphony, right? Planetary awakening and love through unique self-symphony. So there's this sense of, right, we can do this as a symphony. And everyone in the symphony plays a different part. It's not a democratization that everyone's playing the piccolo. That'd be silly, right? Everyone plays their unique instrument, right? And from that, literally you've got the self-organizing universe as a unique self-symphony. So I wanna throw that because that's a new dimension of higher consciousness. That's new. It's a new kind of intimacy, unique self-symphony. And that deserves conversation. So I'm gonna just throw that on the table. Two and three, and then back to you, brother. Second thing I wanna throw on the table is a new practice. And this is a practice that complements our unique self-symphony practice, which is parallel, I think, to your intersubjective non-duality. We should do a whole dialogue just on that, on unique self-symphony, and we've never really compared notes on that. But the second practice is what we call writing outrageous love letters. And I was talking to my friend John Gray, and he said, I've got this love letter practice in Venus Mars, and John's great, and Venus Mars is great. But I said, John, no, it's not that, right? Love letters are a great psychological practice. What we call outrageous love letters is you literally become outrageous love, and you write a person, could be someone you're very close to, it could be a bank clerk, an outrageous love letter, in which you exaggerate till you're accurate, right? So I could write an outrageous love letter to you right now, Andrew, and I could say, I was listening to you talk, and I was just so moved, right, by your commitment, and your eyes were shining, and your glasses were sit perfectly on your face, right, and you were alive, and you were doing what all of reality needs you to do, and I felt the joy moving in you, and I was just so delighted, right, to just be moved by the sound of your voice, right? Now, we're not allowed to do stuff like that, right? Right? In other words, but actually we can. I get to fall in love with you as you're talking, and I get to be excited about that, right? So writing an outrageous love letter is a practice of higher technology, of higher consciousness. And we've made kind of central in our world this daily practice of writing outrageous love letters, right? As a daily practice, so there's meditation, prayer, and a third turning of the wheel, right? Which you can imagine Rumi. You know, when we fall in love with someone, we send them a Rumi poem, right? You know, so we send them a poem from a dead Persian from 800 years ago to tell someone we love them. Nice, right? But actually we can be Rumi, we can be Hafiz, right? And we can actually write the outrageous love letter ourselves. And the reason we read Rumi is because he's writing outrageous love letters. He's writing from that higher state. So we read them because we want to taste and touch that, right? And last short thing, right? Which is just in 10 seconds. And I'm super excited to hear where you're going to pick up and go with any of these or someplace else. There's really just in my own personal experience, Andrew, I move between three things. I move between my psychological self, which is all the stuff, right? We all have a psychological self, and it tells you they don't listen to them. And my psychological stuff is all the past stuff. So the psychological stuff is rooted in the past, and the past kind of defines me. And then I kind of have kind of my mystical self, true self, right? Which is beyond time. Higher consciousness beyond time, right? Timeless time, placeless place. But then the deeper higher consciousness, you know, of what, you know, both of us love Whitehead's phrase, becoming, right? It is my future self. Right? When I'm really there, I feel the call of the future, but I can hear the memory of the future. And when I'm trying to write Dharma or speak Dharma, right, from the inside, I can literally hear the memory of the future coming awake and saying, write me, be me, right? Speak me, right? And that's the future self. So there's this psychological self rooted in the past, this mystical self, absolute present. But what we're talking about is so deeply called by the future. So yay, that's just putting some of that on the table to you, brother.
Beautiful, thank you very much. So I want to try and respond to a couple of things that you beautifully expressed. So first of all, when we're speaking about what we were calling the ego, I mean, the personal ego. So I think that when we're looking at the possibility of transcending the personal ego, so we can awaken to enlightened awareness and to spiritual liberation, I've come to understand, and I know you would wholeheartedly agree, that the personal ego is always mingled with the culturally created What did Freud call it? The superego.
Right.
Because so the superego is the, so our personal felt sense of identity, sense of self is a psychological structure. It's created by our personal history, but our personal history is created in a cultural environment, in a cultural context, with a given set of values and beliefs that we inherently absorb as we grow up in whatever particular cultural setting that we grow up in. And so often when we think about the definition of ego, we think about a personal psychological structure that if we want to understand it, we need to see a psychotherapist or a psychoanalyst to help us understand ourselves. And one of the many things that integral philosophy has helped me to understand is to see that the self is as much culturally created as it is personally created. So for all of us, our personal egos are unenlightened individuated selves are as much created by the shared cultural values that we've absorbed from our familial environment and the world that we grew up in when we were a young person. So most people don't even think their own thoughts. We're so deeply conditioned by the cultural environment in which we've grown up, and we tend to assume that reality is how it shows up for us. But when we wake up spiritually, in the sense that we've been speaking about on this call together, we not only realize that our personal self is just a shell, and that the self that we truly are is actually infinite, that the self is actually, I am that. But we also realize that the world that we are part and parcel of is a creative work that's in process. And so many of the fixed ideas and fixed beliefs that I had that made up my idea of who I was are part of an elastic moving process. And the world as it showed up to me, as the world as it appeared to me when I was a young person, is simply the way it appeared, but it's not necessarily the way it is. And so when we this recognition, this is often a profound recognition that reality is elastic. Reality is how it shows, reality very much has to do with how we see it, not how it actually is. So a big part of the awakening beyond ego is realizing this, and especially if the realization is very, very deep, we realize when we go from egocentric to ethnocentric to world-centric to cosmocentric, we start at the highest level, we realize that I am the whole universe. I am the evolutionary process on the whole universe. I'm the energy and intelligence who created all this. Cognizing itself through this body, mind, personality that's discovered itself in a particular cultural context, in a particular cultural environment. It's all part of a relative, elastic, flowing, creative process that is moving in a state of infinite becoming. And so then we suddenly find that we can choose to be who we believe ourselves to be and who we actually want to be. And we are not necessarily who anybody else has told us that we are. So there's this incredible discovery, this freedom to choose to become a liberated soul and to become an expression of evolution in action, which is, I believe, the highest calling. And I think when you speak about your unique self symphony, you're describing a context, as I understand it, where many individuals at the same time have this kind of insight, have this kind of realization. And the aspiration here, and this is something that I completely concur with you and wholeheartedly and passionately, is when we wake up like this, we want to create a different world space, a different cultural world space in which we can live out and express these higher degrees of realization and self-recognition together with other people that are having similar kinds of awakenings. And so one thing I often like to repeat is when the Buddha was asked the question, his association with like-minded people a part of the holy life? Apparently the Buddha's response was, association with like-minded people is the whole of the holy life. So very much in alignment with everything you've been saying, it's been apparent to me for many years that the countercultural implications of higher states of consciousness is the aspiration to create a new cultural environment, a new cultural context in which we can live out our creative potential and our spiritual potential and our human potential of what you'd call liberated outrageous love and liberate our infinite creative potential individually, collectively, to the fullest. So I want to co-create that world space, that shared cultural world space, that new world, that new spiritual paradise, where we'll all be able to fully become who we can be. And I feel that In the new evolutionary context, unless we can become fully who we're capable of being, in other words, unless I become fully who I'm capable of being, and Marc becomes fully who he's capable of being, I can't be fully alive and I can't be fully liberated. No matter how much Satchitananda I may claim to experience, right, unless in all of my manifest humanity, unless I become all of who I can be, as you would say, outrageously, fully, and completely, then I can't claim to be fully liberated. And so to be able to become fully who I'm capable of being in concert with other spiritual friends and comrades that also are making the spiritual effort to become all they can be, we can create heaven on earth. And I think that's the whole idea.
Yeah, no, gorgeous. And just one word about, you know, shadow, which you kind of talk to, you know, by implication. You know, we have a practice in the community that when someone has a birthday, I think just yesterday was Suzette's birthday, you know, we all write that person a letter, you know, there's a thread and everyone writes an outrageous love letter, right? And, you know, and it doesn't matter where it's, you know, it's a young, old man, woman, transgender, right? In other words, their outrageous love letters are not sexual, they're pure eros, right? You know, you can have, you know, two celibates writing outrageous love letters. It's about the full permission to be that force of outrageous love. But it's not a bypass. It's not, and you can actually feel the difference between something that becomes saccharine and becomes just words. And you can literally feel in your body right? If someone's just doing the words without doing the work, it actually grates on your body. You're like, oh, right? But if it's coming from the place, we're doing the work. We're looking at shadow. We're looking at, you know, when you talk about being liberated from personal ego, it, you know, there's so much conversation, you know, that happens. I'll share with you something, you know, personal for 10 seconds. I got a letter from someone, it doesn't matter who, but a fairly well-known teacher who sent me an apology letter a week ago, because he had signed something that was, you know, publicly a bunch of years back that was, that he shouldn't have signed, that critiqued me. And he said, you know, well, the reason I signed it was because, you know, I was working for someone and I had a bunch of, you know, ego agendas, and I didn't bother to check and I didn't know. And I really want to apologize 5 years later. And I was shocked and delighted to get the letter, because you're so rare you get a letter like that. It's so easy for us to get lost in not having the real conversations, right? It took us thousands of years to get to a place where we can have a conversation. The word Messiah means conversation, right? And all too often, you know, we live in this culture today, particularly in the spiritual community, which instead of awakening goes woke, right? Woke is the danger of awakening that doesn't work. Woke means, right? Woke becomes a kind of self-righteous moment where I feel that I'm higher consciousness, but I then bypass the need to do the shadow work, the need to have a conversation, to sit face to face, right? To work things out, right? So what we're talking about here is, and Andrew and I have talked about this, you know, often over the years in different ways, or the beginnings of a conversation. Nothing we're talking about is what our colleague, who I had the great pleasure to get to know before he passed, John Wellwood, right? John called spiritual bypassing, right? We're not talking here ever about spiritual bypassing. You had a phrase, Andrew, a bunch of years ago when we first met that you shared with me that I loved, which was face everything, avoid nothing, right? It's beautiful, right? Right, and that's exactly right. And that's, we gotta walk through the void, any kind of what I call a void dance, any way of dancing around the void, right? Doesn't work. We gotta walk through it, and being willing to hold hands as we walk through it and do the difficult stuff. And I'm often shocked, Andrew, how I'll hear people, and I apologize, albeit insincerely, for being so direct about this, right? But I'll hear people who will talk about, let's make peace between the Palestinians and Israelis, and the fact that terrorists have killed each other's children, we need to move beyond that. But in their own worlds and communities, on relatively minor issues, they can't even begin to have a conversation. When that happens, the integrity of the spiritual community collapses. And if we can't model what it means to have a conversation, if we can't model what it means to walk through it, if we can't model what it means to transform, if we can't do our cleanup, right, together with our awakening, and instead we go woke, right? That's tragic, right? We gotta be able to talk to each other. We gotta be able to have conversations. We gotta be able to honor each other. We gotta be able to forgive each other. We gotta be able to hold each other in our complexity. So that's one. And the second thing, and then, you know, I think we're gonna move towards questions in closing. But here's just the second thing, just one sentence. One of my teachers, Andrew, who passed away before I was born, Abraham Cook, has a mystical diary, which we've never talked about. We'd love to just look at it together. And it's called The Mist of Purity. And he has one sentence there where he says, like, you know, a person has to ask, who am I? So he wants to answer the question of who am I? So he has this great sentence where he says, and I remember reading it, it just blew my heart open in a thousand pieces. He says, Amitat mahuti mitgale berig'ei gadluti. Right? The essence of who I am is revealed in my moment of greatness. Right? And so beautiful, right? That everyone has moments of greatness. And those are my moments of prophecy. Those are my moments of higher consciousness. And I, you know, and I always share with people around me, if they ask me for a practice, I say, sit down, write your sacred autobiography, and identify your moments of greatness when spirit spoke through you, and you'll find them, and write them down, like actually write them down and make them the center of your life. So we can be in this, what Andrew calls intersubjective non-duality together, and this manifest nirvana, your beautiful name, together. We can be in this planetary awakening and love unique self symphonies together. So I thought, Andrew, you know, spontaneously, maybe the way we could end before any questions is, I mean, maybe we'll each take 2 minutes and just step in. I mean, we're inside. I feel inside higher consciousness with you right now. But maybe just for a second, you know, I know that meditation is a strong you know, practice of yours, and chant is a strong practice of mine. And maybe we'll each do just a, you know, 90 second or two minute kind of meditation chant. We can just kind of just step inside and be together in that for a second. Would that work for you?
Sure, I'll do my best.
Okay, here we go.
Putting me on the spot. So who goes first?
After you, sir.
Okay.
Is that okay?
Yeah. I'm thinking, which I shouldn't be doing. Marc and I promised each other that we wouldn't do any planning or thinking before we did these dialogues. So I'll just speak a little bit about meditation for about 90 seconds. In my understanding, and this is what my guru revealed to me directly, that that a meditation and the awakening to enlightened awareness are the same thing. So meditation and enlightenment, if the meditation is real, is not separate from the state of consciousness that is enlightenment itself. So my understanding of meditation is what meditation is the contemplation of consciousness. Meditation is the contemplation of consciousness. And when we begin to contemplate the nature of consciousness, we realize that consciousness is timeless and formless, beginningless and endless, and eternal, uncreated, and as the Buddha said, unborn. So when we contemplate the nature of our own consciousness, spontaneously, ecstatically, without making any effort, in a state of deep ease and acceptance and surrender, we suddenly become cognizant of the fact that the deepest interior dimension of our own being exists everywhere and nowhere simultaneously, that we are everywhere and nowhere all the time, that we are the innermost corner of the entire universe, bearing witness to itself through the body, mind, personality of this, as Marc would say, unique self. But in fact, who and what we are more than anything else is that which is timeless and formless and beginningless and endless, eternal, uncreated and unborn, always and forever. And sometimes when we're conscious of this dimension of who we are, this absolute dimension of who we are, sometimes we forget because we get lost in time and lost in thought. So to meditate is simply to bring our attention back to who we always truly are when we're awake, which is timeless and formless and beginningless and endless and eternal and uncreated and unborn. We exist everywhere and nowhere simultaneously. And in our most awake moments, in our most awakened moments, this becomes self-evident and obvious and apparent to us that we are everywhere and nowhere, always and forever. And when we discover this deeply and are able to surrender and accept this truth, we set ourselves free.
And in that freedom, in that liberation, we realize that every place we fall into the hands of she. And David and Solomon, our teachers, sang it like this, and I'll do it with the original lineage words and translate it. Mizmor shir le'yom ha'Shabbat, tov le'hodot la'Adonai, to sing a song of spirit, it's good, Andrew, to sing with thee. O Mizmor shir le'yom ha'Shabbat, it's good to sing with we. Le'agin ba'boker chazdecha ve'emunatcha ba'leilot, to speak of your love in the morning and to trust you through the night. To speak of your love in the morning and to trust you through the night. To speak of your love in the morning and to trust you through the night. To speak of your love in the morning and to trust you through the night. To speak of your love in the morning and to trust you through the night. So gently in this space, turn to Daniela, Krista. Are we taking questions now? Comments? Jokes?
Jokes. Thank you so much, Andrew, Marc. So beautiful. Speak of your love in the morning. We have a few people already in the chat box who shared their questions, so I'm going to read those. If you have a question, please write it in the chat box and I will find it there and do my best to ask them all. I want to start with Natalie, and her question is, how do we organize and promote a real life politics of compassion or outrageous love that can spread across countries and really impact politics and activism?
Andrew, you wanna?
I'll go after you.
Okay, it's a great question. It's a great question. Here's the, and we'll be short on each of these. Each one of these is a world and a dialogue, but it's a great, and thank you so much for the inquiry. We need what we call a universal grammar of value. Okay, so I'm just going to just give you one moment. And again, I'm going to be super, super brief so we can go and at least get through some of the questions. But I'm going to give you a moment. We're in the trial this week in the United States, those of you who are in the United States, of Derek Chauvin, who killed George Floyd. All right, and it was a horrific moment. It was witnessed by the entire country, right? Everyone literally saw it. Everyone saw a murder take place. And there was this moment where people were jolted out of their stupor and they experienced a violation of value, right? Value had been violated. And that experience of a violation of value triggered, right, the explosion of Black Lives Matter. And obviously there were multiple things happening. When we step out of the Tao, meaning we step out of value, when everything is a social construction, right? When we get lost in, you know, a perspectival madness, right? There's no sense that we're in intrinsic value, then we can't arouse political action. Political action comes from political will. Political will is aroused by aligning with a value or standing against the violation of a value. When there's no grammar of value, which is a shared universal grammar of value, then we can't activate political will. So the first step to activating political will, which is at the core of what we're thinking about at the center in One Mountain, is to actually activate a universal grammar of value, which then arouses political will. That's a lot in that, but let me hold there. That's a big deal, and it's a great, I'm super, super glad you asked that question. Thank you, Andrew.
So just very, very briefly, Al, I think that I agree with Marc that we need to have a shared universal grammar of value. And my understanding of what that means is that from the biggest possible perspective, the solution to the problems that human beings create always boils down to the evolution of consciousness. So why did things go wrong? The reason that things went wrong is because of greed, arrogance, superiority, and selfishness in some individual and collective form. And this is part and parcel of human culture and has been, and has been that way forever. So when we begin to awaken spiritually, we, and especially when we discover evolution, we realize that the universe is in a state of becoming and complexifying and becoming at the highest level more and more conscious. And the evolution of consciousness applies very much to us human beings. So if we could, if more and more of the human race could appreciate that we're all on an evolutionary trajectory, and that consciousness is trying to become more conscious through us. If we could begin to share this value that we're on a moving train, and the train's moving towards the future, more and more people could become interested in evolution as a shared universal value, one that we all cherish, and we realize that our shared future, that the security of our shared future, and ultimately the future of the biosphere and the future of all the sentient beings on this planet, are very much dependent upon the evolution of human consciousness. So if this simple but profound and radical idea could be shared universally and become part of a shared universal grammar of value by at least half the human race, I think it could take us a long way.
Thank you. Wow. There's a lot of comments coming in. I just want you both to know that some people are also just sharing their appreciation and thank you. So there's a lot happening there. And the next question is coming from Terry. And he says, my son Topher, he's 23. What does he need to do in his egocentric state before trying to move beyond it? You're muted, Mark.
Unmute there. Yeah, awesome. And maybe our host just we'll hold those mute buttons ourselves. That's awesome. Thank you. So Andrew, if it's okay, since I know Topher, and I'm gonna jump in on that one. So I would say like this to Terry, right? And I think this is okay to share. Topher and I just exchanged a voicemail yesterday, and Topher is Terry's son, who's a wondrous, brilliant young man who can bench press 275 pounds, just to say. And Topher's gotten very, very interested in blockchain, right? Blockchain technology. And we just talked about yesterday about, does the world just need a new ledger, which is what blockchain is, which, you know, provides, you know, better encryption, better identification, right? But how could you use blockchain as a spiritual tool, right? How could you use blockchain, right, as a methodology of consciousness? And what I said to Topher was, and he just texted me back, you know, super excited, you know, lots of insight. So Topher has this, and it's an example for everyone. So Topher has a specific emergent brilliance in understanding blockchain. And that's a moment of greatness. And I think it's for him, he happens to be what, 25, right? That's a new revelation, right? Wonderful mind and heart. And he could step into that in a way that I can't and Andrew can't. Right? We're not going to be able to do in blockchain what Topher will. So for Topher to actually step in it, that's the moment, that's a moment of greatness. And it's a great example. And you're pulled from your personal ego that Andrew was describing by stepping into your moment of greatness. And your moment of greatness sometimes is about an idea. Sometimes it's about being, you know, holding space and creating capacity, right, for other people, right? It's about being on a team. There's different instruments in the unique self symphony. But when I play my instrument pulls me, the music of my instrument pulls me out of my personal ego. Andrew.
Well, I think that I've always thought it's a good idea to put first things first. So I know that a lot of people become interested in philosophy and metaphysics, and trying to understand reality and finding out what the truth is, often after they've spent half their life doing other things. And so I think that I always want to encourage people to find out what is the deepest and highest truth about reality first, because first of all, is there such a thing as the highest truth? A lot of people think there is, and they think everything is relative. But the greatest realizers throughout history all tell us, no, there is an absolute truth, there is an absolute reality. And they say, if you discover this absolute truth, discover this absolute reality, it will give you a completely different perspective. So what I would encourage you to do, being still a young person, is to seek out, is to find out if such a truth exists, such a higher reality exists. And I can tell you from my own experience that I have no doubt that it does. And if a lot of people agree with me, as Mark does. And if you discover the highest truth, And then it will be your North Star. You'll be able to organize your relative human existence, your relative human life, in relationship to this highest reality. And then the feeling will be, there's a sense of being very much at the center of creation, the center of the creative process, being at the right time in the right place for the right reasons. When your life is in alignment with the highest truth and the deepest and most profound understanding of reality itself. And so it's what I would encourage you to do as a young person is to have faith that such a truth actually exists, and dedicate a few years of your life to doing whatever you need to do to find it. Because if you do, it'll change everything. I promise you that.
Beautiful. Beautiful. Krista.
Here's a question from Shante. I'm just going to read it as it says here. How to handle being a subject of comparison bias? And the explanation is that it's about being falsely accused, and whatever I do, people are still believing that I'm someone else than that I really am. How to break that pattern while being all that I am?
Andrew?
I can relate to your predicament for my own reasons. And in the end, we have to have the courage and the audacity to stand for our truth, to stand for what we know the truth to be, no matter what other people may think, no matter if that's what a lot of people think. Just because a lot of people agree about something doesn't mean they're right, doesn't mean they're seeing you clearly or seeing reality clearly or even seeing themselves clearly. So reality is very confusing, and I'm 65 years old, and I've learned about how partial most people's understanding of reality and of themselves are, and how lost and confused so many human beings are, and how easily influenced we are. Most people's minds are very fickle. Very few people are standing in a place of deep self-confidence that comes from really knowing who you are and knowing what reality is all about. So I would encourage you to have the courage, and I tell myself the same thing, not to care what other people think, not to care.
Yeah,
I'll be very transparent with you. I'm living in India, and I went to see, for the first time in my life, I went to see a Vedic astrologer 2 days ago with my wife for a short meeting. And I was speaking with the Vedic astrologer about the fact that some relationships in my life, that's in relation with people that I cared about very much, have broken apart in a terrible way. I said, would these relationships ever be healed? And the Vedic astrologer, before I was even finished what I was saying, he said, you're attached. He was shouting, that's not the way. You have to be free. And so considering myself a teacher of liberation, it was humiliating and invigorating at the same time and inspiring. And it was very helpful. So he was shouting me to let go. So we have to let go of that which is unnecessary. And some people never understand this. And we have to believe in ourselves. That's what we've got to do. We have to believe in ourselves with great courage and great passion and great audacity.
Yeah, no, beautiful, right? And got to talk later about what else the Vedic astrologer said. So yay for Vedic astrologers. I just want to share in Andrew, in the vein, just also just, you know, a transparent moment, because this notion of falsely accused is a big deal, right? We live in a kind of cancel culture, and we live in a culture in which conversations that should happen don't happen. And I just want to share a moment, you know, like Andrew did, which I hope will be helpful to you, right? And thank you so much for the question. Which is, it was 2006, and I was in a moment of actually being falsely accused, and even my friend Andrew, right, I hadn't heard from, right? Yeah, it was a hard moment in 2006, right? And there we go, and I didn't know whether I was going to be able to recover my computer, which I needed, which thank God I was able to, which cleared it, and showed that it was categorically false, but I didn't know. And my computer had been erased. I didn't know if I'd be able to. It was an insanely painful moment. And I got up to go to a lawyer's office in downtown Salt Lake. And I was staying with my friend Kirk and Krista. And Kristen Ulmer is a skier. I was staying at their house kind of near Snowbird in Salt Lake City, Utah. And I go to get the bus. And I'm probably the only person who ever rode the bus in Salt Lake City. So it took an hour to come, and it was sweltering hot, and I just got an email from Ken Wilber about some, and it was just a hard moment. And, you know, I'm waiting. The bus comes. I just look at the bus. I just can't get on. The bus just keeps going. And then this other car pulls up and says, "Hey, I thought I would see you today. You want to get in? I'll give you a ride." So I figured it must be an axe murderer, but I kind of felt like dying anyway. So I said, "I'll get in." So I get into the car, and there's a Mormon woman about 55. And I say, "How long is it to, you know, get into Salt Lake?" And she says, "It's about 45 minutes, and I'll drive you." Because I had an intuition I was going to meet someone this morning, I would drive them. So we start talking, and I just asked her about her life. "Who are you? What's your life?" And we got deep into this conversation about her life, where I was really just listening. It was an incredibly painful, agonizing, gorgeous, ecstatic story. And I was transfixed. And I just listened to her for 40 minutes, and I just would ask questions and listen. And I went to get out of the car, and I'd completely forgotten everything that was going on and all of the false accusations. And she looked at me, and she was Mormon. And she said, "Who are you? Are you the high priest?" And I got out of the car and I laughed, and I realized that no matter what happened, if I wouldn't be able to recover my computer, right, if it would be like the biggest disaster that would possibly happen, right, I'd be falsely accused, I'd have no evidence to show that it wasn't true, and I'd go to prison, for example, right, you know, or something like that. Then I would go to prison, I would listen to people's stories, and I'd try and reflect how beautiful they were, and that'd be a great life. Now, the only reason I have the audacity to share that with you, because that was actually my experience, right, that's actually what happened. And I had to actually get to that place that Andrew just described beautifully, of just give it all up and then actually live and be, right, who I was. And from that moment on, I remember the moment, that morning, when I got out of that car, things shifted. It shifted because I had given it all up. And I realized I could actually be me, as you said so beautifully in your question, no matter what. And it might look very different than I thought, but it's actually real. Okay. Yeah, let's just do a couple more, Krista, right? I've got all the time in the world, but I know that people are on. So whatever you and Daniela decide, I'm good.
Yes. Yes, definitely. Here's another one. Coming from Colleen. In this no-touch COVID climate, how might outrageous love be best shared with those who are blindly paralyzed and lost from trauma?
Beautiful. Andrew?
I mean, with love and compassion and kindness, as much love and compassion as kindness is what we're capable of. No, there's no mystery. You know, in the next dialogue, Marc and I wanted to talk about the nature of suffering, and we're very much looking forward to it. But I think that if we have suffered and we know what it means to suffer, then we learn about the nature of compassion. The suffering helps us to learn about compassion and understand how significant it is. And suffering deeply wakes us up to the suffering, not only to our own suffering, but the suffering of other people, and it brings us closer to God. And so if we have suffered, we will know how to express kindness, compassion, and care to other people in appropriate ways at appropriate times for appropriate reasons. I don't think there's any particular recipe. It's something we will find our way if we know what it means to suffer.
Yeah, beautiful, beautiful. And big, big amen, Andrew, to what you said. And so I'll just pick up then on the first part of the question, because you talked so beautifully about the second, which you asked, you know, in this no touch moment, right? That's how you described it in your question. And you're of course right, right? In other words, we all want to be touched. We want to be touched and hugged physically. We also want to be touched emotionally, and we want to be touched spiritually, and we want to be touched existentially, right? In other words, you know, there's a proto desire in molecules to touch each other. Whitehead called it prehension. So in reality, we want to, that's what he means. He means it's a proto desire to make contact, to touch. And this tragic moment of COVID, where we can't just, right? We can't shake hands, right? We can't give each other a hug, right? And there's actually a kind of a body hunger and a soul hunger, right, to be with other people. And so this is a moment, as Andrew, you said so beautifully, right? And I'll just put it in our language, write outrageous love letters, right? Be outrageous, right? Be dramatic. And actually step in to the moment, right? As a moment that gives you permission to be an outrageous lover, right? To actually reach out, to create a Zoom call and just pour love into someone, but not indiscriminately, not in a saccharine way, but you actually practice, right? Practice being an outrageous lover. Be roomy, be afiz, right? I mean, step into that part of you, right? And love it open. And so this is a moment when we live in one extreme, right? To Aristotle and in his Wake, Aquinas and Maimonides, when we're in one extreme, go to the other extreme. If we can't touch physically, it means we can't shake hands, right? Right? You know, and elbow bumps don't quite do it, right? Then let's go to the other extreme in terms of touching spiritually, intellectually, and emotionally, and touch more than we ever have, like that. Thank you. Krista.
Yes, the next question is, have you defined the mechanisms of what it takes to be directly addressed as a unique self in that symphony? The mechanism, the mechanics of that divine empowerment.
Andrew, I'm sure you've talked about the process of intersubjective non-duality. And I think I'll say, you know, after Andrew, I'll turn to Andrew first, but we'll say a couple of sentences on it. We actually need to do a whole dialogue on this at some point. It's such a big topic, but take it away, and I'll follow you, sir.
Well, my life experience of teaching for over 35 years at this point tells me that we need to put some time and some practice and some learning into this process, and it takes most people time to discover the difference between the ego and the unique self, the ego and the authentic self, the ego and the true self. And this is a matter of experience and practice. And after a while, we begin to learn the difference between these different dimensions of ourselves. And so if we're going to create a unique self symphony, we need to be able, that's only gonna be able to happen if we can do that in the context with other people who have a measure of experience, who know how to awaken to their authentic selves, to their unique selves, and how to stay there and how to keep their ego, leave their egos outside the door. So it's time and practice. And this is something that we can get better and better and better at. Some people actually get to a point of mastery, but it's very, very rare. But it's a learning process. It's like learning how to do anything. It takes time to become an expert and to become good at it. But the better we become, at a certain point, we are able to facilitate this process in such a way that makes it easier for other people to understand this flip that happens. Because there's a flip when I flip from my ego to my authentic self or to my unique self. It's like a flip. It's like changing a lens on a camera. We discover a completely different dimension of ourselves. It's been there the whole time. We just didn't realize it. And so we learn how to make that flip, that transition. And as I said, when we get very good at it, we can help to facilitate other people at it. But it takes time, it takes practice, it takes learning, and something we need to aspire to want to gain mastery in. But if you get a group of people who are working on this, we can help each other. Because if you're in a group of people, and let's say there's 15 people or 30 people, and let's say 28 people are have flipped into their unique selves, into their authentic selves, it'll make it much easier for those two people that don't know how to do it to just make that flip without even knowing what happened. Because the center of gravity is so different. So this flip is like creating a different vortex in individual and collective shared consciousness. And it's co-creating a new portal, a new dimension in the shared space of human consciousness. And when this shared portal becomes strong, and it becomes strong, if there are people that are very grounded in this flip and know how to make this flip, know how to stay there, when people who are very strong come together, this new world space, this new enlightened world space, begins to become more and more firmly established, and it becomes easier and easier for other people to get there because other people are holding that space. So anyway, I think Marc and I should dedicate a whole 2 hours. Time spot to talk about it, but it takes time, it takes practice, it takes effort, and it takes dedication.
Yeah, thank you, Andrew. And I'll answer this, and then I saw Krista that you were getting on the phone, and I assume you weren't calling your mom. So my guess is you were texting Daniela to figure out how much more time, right, we have, or maybe you weren't. Okay, so let me answer this and then tell us, give us like a framework for time so we'll know where we are. Okay, perfect, right? Meaning 10, right? 10 minutes, okay, fantastic. So here's a big sentence, okay? Three words, find the others. All right, that's number one, find the others, right? And number two, find a teacher, right? You know, in other words, and three, you know, find a dharma, right? And those are three pieces that I don't think we can do without. So find the others means you need community, right? And you can't do it by yourself. Ultimately, there can be periods of time, obviously, of solitary work. There's times that we step inside. We might do a solitary retreat. We might go on a vision quest. But ultimately, practice takes place in community. And everyone's invited, right, to come to one mountain, to come to manifest nirvana, right, to find other places to practice, right? But we have to be practicing together for real, and we got to take that seriously. I want to just tell you something funny for just 10 seconds. A friend of mine is a pastor of a church. And, you know, she's actually a great person, not a great pastor, right? And I was always kind of shocked that, you know, her church, which was a particular denomination of Catholicism, right? Her church had a number of not good pastors, right? You know, who just were in the wrong job, but the church somehow survived because everyone got that there needed to be, you know, a Catholic church there, you know, in this particular town in middle America. And whenever I would watch that story, I watched it over 25 years, I got the power of organized religion, right? In other words, that there was this commitment. There was this unshakable commitment that this church is going to go on. And one of the things that in the human potential community we don't have, right, and we need to actually bring that dimension of consciousness to the table, is this absolute commitment to building a community and to building a community at the leading edge and to building it no matter what, right? So a radical dedication to community is the move from egocentric to ethnocentric. Egocentric, I can be fully in my own spiritual path. I'm egocentric. Ethnocentric means I'm actually going to be committed to a community, which is a big deal. So a community and then a teacher. And if you can find a great live teacher, fantastic. And teachers are imperfect, right? But teachers holding something the same way you'd go in physics to train with a physicist, right? So if you're training in spirit, you want to be with someone, right, who's trained for decades, right? You might, you know, I often have done that through books, right? You know, my major teacher died in 1848, right? That's a particular path in the Hebrew lineage that we follow, that we enter so deeply in a text. And I spent a year, 20 hours a day reading his text, immersed in his text after studying him for 10 years and then wrote 2000 pages on him as a dedication to him. So that's a particular unique path I wouldn't advise to anyone. But in other words, you can also find teachers in the written word, right? So find the others, right? You know, find a community, right? Find a teacher. And in the end, the last thing is to create a unique, you need to have a shared dharma in the community, okay? And it changes everything so that we're sharing a language together, right? Which changes everything. So those three are a great set of steps. And places like One Mountain or Manifest Nirvana, we're trying to do something not just for our community. We're not actually interested in starting a local church. We're interested in trying to create a model for ourselves and for reality, right, in these Dharma laboratories of what's possible. So these are uniquely exciting communities, right, in that we're trying to actually take responsibility in this larger way. It's not a local community. It's a community that's trying to be in world and cosmos-centric consciousness, that's trying to discover what's possible. And so direct, huge invitation. Yeah. Krista.
Yes, I think this would be the last question. We have 7 minutes.
Fantastic.
It's actually my own question, or actually your question. Both of you wrote in the introduction about, is there hierarchy in enlightenment and the stages of development that we can go through on this path of enlightenment? And I would love for you to speak into that.
Sure.
Well, I mean, Kirsten, there's no doubt that some people are more enlightened than others. I know that's not a very politically correct thing to say, but it's it's true there. It's spirituality in certain ways is very much like any other field of human endeavor. Some people are more gifted, more talented, and more spiritually precocious, and more spiritually committed than others. So I know that when I met I had many spiritual teachers before I met my guru, but when I met my guru, I realized that he was grounded in a completely different dimension of spiritual attainment than anybody I'd ever met. I realized this was a whole different category of, as you said, spiritual attainment. So some people are more enlightened than others. Some people are more stabilized in their realization than other people. Many people have spiritual experiences. What I often like to say is it's easy to get enlightened, but it's much easier to fall back asleep. So many people have wake up experiences on retreats and in all different kinds of ways. It's possible to wake up briefly. So a lot of people wake up and they have a glimpse of absolute reality, but inevitably they fall back asleep. So most people wake up and fall back asleep. Some people wake up in such a profound way that they actually stay awake, maybe not perfectly, but in such a way that there's an obvious, there's a discernible and very dramatic difference between such individuals and everybody else, and they're called spiritual masters. That doesn't mean that they're perfect human beings, or they have a perfect level of realization or perfect attainment, because that's a mythic idea. It's an outdated idea. Such things have never existed, but they've achieved a level of stability and a high level of attainment that is rare and very precious. And this is true in Judaism, esoteric Christianity, Buddhism and Vedanta, and evolutionary spirituality. It's true in all fields of human endeavor. And I think that the understanding spirit exists on a horizontal axis, but also it's the vertical nature of spirit that's so thrilling. The spirit itself is trying to ascend as us, through us. And it's reaching. And not everybody's in the same place. And I know our postmodern sensibilities don't like the fact that somebody could be, God forbid, somebody could be more spiritually evolved than we are. So really? Because the point is, the word spiritual points to the deepest, we believe, points to the deepest dimension of our humanity. And our postmodern sensibilities are deeply offended by the fact that anybody could be more deeply evolved as a human being in the deepest sense of what that could possibly mean. So some people are more enlightened than others, thank God, because then they can help us. We can learn from them. They can help us to wake up, and they can guide us along the way, and they can be exemplars for us. If they're the real deal and they're truly sincere and authentic, they can be exemplars of the possible for us and inspire us when we need it the most. So God bless the greatest spiritual masters that have ever lived and that are alive today, because they're all here only to help us.
Yeah, beautiful. Beautiful. And Krista, it's a great inquiry, and it brings us in. We'll close with this. It brings us to that conversation we didn't actually quite get to, which is the democratization of enlightenment. What does democratization mean? And so the democratization of enlightenment, which is a term I wrote in a book called, these two volumes called Radical Kabbalah and A Unique Self, right, is in complete concert with what Andrew just described. And there's no contradiction, right, between those two. And it's, hierarchy is the nature of the world. And hierarchy just means, right, that, you know, for example, Stephen Hawking, right, was better at physics than I am. But that's a hierarchy, right? Right. And my opinion about physics isn't actually that important, right? Although I read physics all the time, you know, and, you know, Steve Weinberg, right, who won the Nobel Prize on muons, right, is much better at muons than I am. And Albert Einstein was better at physics than I am. Now stay close for a second. And Albert Einstein, and I apologize for saying this, but it's actually true, was an absolute idiot, right, when he talked about any number of other things, for which we quote him all the time. Oh, Albert Einstein said. But Albert Einstein actually knew nothing about those things. He was parroting the superficial views of his age. And because he was a really good physicist, we ascribe to him authority in other areas. So Steven Weinberg, for example, made, you know, some comment about the purpose of cosmos, which was idiocy, right? Complete and absolute. And Weinberg himself wrote, right, that he regretted saying it was taken out of context. But because he's a physicist, that comment has been quoted time and again. And I can't tell you how many people who in certain circles read that comment and came to me brokenhearted because he talked about the cosmos being pointless, right? And they said, he's a physicist, right? He's this great physicist of muons that know the essential nature of reality. Well, no, physics is talking about a particular dimension of reality. And Steven Weinberg knows nothing, right, about, right, the other topics, which he's never studied, he's never looked into. And he was operating at a high school level in those other topics while he was operating, right, at a physics level, right, super advanced Nobel Prize level. We were talking about physics. And I just want to say that because that really gives us the notion of hierarchy. Hierarchy means we actually don't democratize, right, in the sense that everything has equal authority, right? Something has authority if it's authored from a place of deep integrity and deep commitment and deep love, right, and deep time, right, and deep knowing, right? And we need to actually honor, and then there's this postmodern move to undermine expertise, to undermine great art, to undermine great literary works, right? To undermine, right? Well, no, actually we need to dive in, and we get to all be delighted, right? And learn from each other, right? And a unique self symphony. And so there's a natural hierarchy in reality, which is Rhian Eisler was a great feminist, you know, beautifully called. She was at our Passover Seder and she talked about it. She called it a holistic hierarchy and not a dominator hierarchy. And that's a critical distinction. So yay, thank you, Krista.
Fabulous. Ah, we did it.
We did it. Thank you, everyone. Can we see everyone for a second? Right? Just bring everyone on, just kind of say hi and goodbye and light it and thank you.